ties for the time of praise singing led by Rob.
Thank you, Bonnie. That's one of, in that song is one of God's names. Andy walks with me, and he talks with me. So, are you joining me in singing? We're going to start with, Lord, I lift your name on high.
Thank you.
morning.
Good morning.
My name is Darlene Richardson. I am not Greg Rackow. He's more handsome than I am. But I will be your liturgist this morning. Please join me in our call to worship. We'll read responsibly. Come to Christ, that living stone, rejected by the world, but in God's sight, chosen and precious.
Live on the Christ fall, and seek to be welded into a spiritual house, a living reminder of God's presence on earth.
Once we were no people, but now we are God's people, called out of darkness into God's marvelous light. Therefore, we sing with the church of all ages.
Blessed be your name, O God, our Redeemer. By your mercy, we have born anew to the living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Amen.
You may be seated, and will the children come forward for children's time? Many of you have ever heard someone say, sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt me. You've heard that? All right. All right. Now, how many of you believe that's actually true? Believe that words can't hurt people? Nobody believes that's true, huh? Well, words can hurt people. Most grown-ups I know can remember something that was said to them when they were about your age that hurt them, and I know I can. But in the same way words have power to hurt, they also have power to help and make us feel good. And there's a verse in the Bible that talks about how God wants us to use our words to help others. It's found in 1 Thessalonians. And the first part of it says, encourage one another and build each other up. So I looked the word encouraged up in the dictionary, even though I knew what it meant. And the dictionary said that encourage means to give courage, hope, or confidence to give support or help. So don't let anyone tell you that you can't encourage others because you're too young. The Bible talks about that too. So even though you are younger, you have a big part in encouraging people. I'm going to give each of you a small piece of paper, and I want each of you to read the words written on your papers one at a time, okay? Thank you.
please rise for our hymn number 593.
Normal we had a praise band. I played bass, and there was another lady that played guitar. One of the pastors, Tom Robinson, played guitar. But we had a nice time, a nice picnic down there. We did some puzzle games, and everybody just had a wonderful time. And the United Methodist Connection Group was the group that provided the desserts, provided cookies and cakes, and everybody there had a good time. They really appreciated all the work that United Methodist Connection did up here. So Patty, thanks for helping get that started. Okay?
Any other joys? Yes.
Praise for Christian music and speakers that are kind of touching into our community. So Toby Mack is coming for the Bloomsburg Fair, that's great. And Uprise Festival is down in Shippensburg in 3 weeks. And I wasn't aware, but there's a big festival every year down at Disney in Orlando, and it's enormous. Newsboys and all kind of people are there. So it's a great opportunity for us to get the message out in an effective and exciting way.
Absolutely. I'm a big fan of Toby Mack, news for all those folks. Yep, that's all over here. Yep, he's a big proponent of that. Yes, Amy.
My mom had a heart attack immunization on Friday. Mm-hmm. They put a stent in one of her vessels, they ballooned her aorta, and hopefully that will solve the problem that we were going to have extended out. We will see eventually. She feels good. Sure. Her arm is really, really bruised because she had a lot of bleeding underneath the skin. But she had a really nice young man, like, grabbing and unwrapping her arm for like an hour and a half.
Some of the other folks that we were asked to pray for earlier today, the mother of a young girl named Brianna, one of Lydia's, thank you, all of a sudden Lily stuck in my head, that is not right, Lydia's teammates apparently is suffering from stage 4 cancer, so prayers for Brianna's mother dealing and her family. Prayers for Mike, he has surgery on Tuesday. Keeping Candy and Elaine and Mary Lou in our prayers. Paul, prayers for Paul, who's having back surgery in January or February. I see Phyllis is here, so prayers continue for you, Phyllis, yes. And we also were praying for Mabel this morning, so I'm glad to hear Joy that she's doing well and recovering from her capitalization. Okay. And a prayer request for Justin, keeping Justin in our prayer. So let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come together in worship of you and in prayer for all of the joys and concerns for births and engagements, for healing that is taking place. We are so grateful that we can
continue to cover folks in prayer who are still in need of continued healing, of situations in our lives that we are struggling with. We want to keep hurricane victims, our government, our service folks, whether they be serving abroad or our men and women in uniform locally, police officers, firemen, especially for Aaron, who's healing from a broken wrist. May he return to full capacity soon. Prayers for Vern as he continues to learn and grow in his wisdom and gain knowledge in the financial area. May that be a blessing to others as well. And I am blessed to be here trying to fill his shoes. We pray all these things, Lord, wrapping them together and sending them to you with the prayer that you gave us through your Son Jesus. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, upon earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Amen. For our next hymn, number 420, Breathe On Me, Breath of God.
Thank you.
strengthen and further your kingdom here on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our first scripture lesson comes from the Old Testament, the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 6, verses 5 through 9. And you shall love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words which I command you this day shall be upon your heart. And you shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise. And you shall bind them as a sign upon your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. And you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Our second scripture reading is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 22, verses 34 through 40. When the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they came together. And one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? And he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. May God bless the reading and the hearing of his holy words.
Wearing head stuff, so I'm just going to use the handheld. So are any of you as surprised as me that I'm up here speaking in front of you today?
No.
Not really?
No.
Was it a surprise that I was here? I mean, I don't know how many, some of you knew. I kind of shared with Shannon. I think, of course, worship leaders knew that I would be up here today based on the information, but I'm surprised to be here. A week ago, I would not have expected to be here. Byrne told me on Tuesday, because I knew his time for going to the conference that he was attending this weekend was coming up. I said, did you buy your plane ticket yet? He said, no, I'm not going to go. And I said, why not? I mean, you've been preparing for this for 2.5 or more years. I mean, why wouldn't you go? You've invested so much in it. And he said, oh, I have too much to do, and I don't have anybody to preach for me on Sunday. And I said, well, why not? I mean, I thought you arranged it. No, I didn't. He said, well, if you get somebody to preach for you, will you go? No one's going to preach for me on short notice, he said. And I said, all right. And I just felt this little, some words came out of my mouth I did not expect to hear. If you go, I will speak for you. I said, but only if you go. And he said, you know you do that? I said, yeah, I've had some things on my heart lately that I think it's time to share. So he said, all right, if I can get my plane ticket arranged, then I'll go. So he did and got his plane tickets and took off Friday morning and here I am. So. I mean, I've been surprised before in worship. I remember the first surprise I had was probably when I was 7 or 8 years old, and my dad got up, and he preached. He gave the message because the pastor was away or something. I don't remember a thing he said, but I do remember it was a surprise to see my dad up there speaking. I mean, he's a great man, spiritual man, but never saw him in a pulpit before. Been surprised by, in my travels, having gone places, speakers that said things that were inspiring and great things to hear. Probably my most inspiring lately, or in recent time, is someone I wish to emulate someday. Not that I want to be a preacher. I do not want to be a preacher. Don't get that wrong. I don't mind speaking little bits and pieces from time to time, but that's not my calling. But spreading God's word and being a spokesman for God is. So if I can do that sometimes and follow the example of my friend Praveen, who lives in India. Praveen is a guy like me. I mean, he's a guy who grew up with Christian parents, which is rare in India. I mean, he's a native of India, but both of his parents were Christian, raised him in a Christian lifestyle, taught him how to serve. I think he was kind of immersed in it and didn't really think too hard about it as he was a young man growing up and into a young adulthood. And then at some point he went through a little bit of a depression. And when he came out of it, he was on fire for God. He just became a 180-degree different person. Not that he wasn't a good person before, but he was just on fire. And today, he's an evangelist. He goes around from town to town, sets up his podium and his stage, and plays music and preaches and encourages people and prays with them almost daily, pretty much every day, in addition to all the other work he does. Which, all going, that's a whole other sermon for another time. I could talk on end about India. But then recently, just in the last few months, I heard two other speakers that really spoke to my heart. I wasn't even present in person to hear them speak, but it happened right here, right up there. Thanks to the internet and YouTube, days that I missed that I really wanted to hear, I was able to go back and listen. First one was about 3 months ago, when Pastor Susan gave the message on Memorial Day weekend. I wanted to hear the Memorial Day service. I know it was great music, it's very inspirational and patriotic, but I never heard Pastor Susan speak. I didn't ever get to hear one of her sermons, so I tuned into YouTube and listened to her preach, expecting to hear, thankfulness to our servicemen and women, and, her experience in the service, and I heard something completely different. I don't even remember if you did say something about that. You may have, but that's not what I heard. What I heard was revival. What I heard was prayer. That our community should be turning to God and praying in humility for revival. And that spoke to me. There was just something about her exhortation, her encouragement of that touched my heart. And I said, that is exactly what Praveen does. That's exactly what I want to be doing. And what I think our community, our state, our country needs to be doing. But we can only start with what's in front of us. And we certainly know Shemokin and the surrounding area benefit from that. The next person was just 2 weeks ago. I never got to hear Becky and Aaron talk about Haiti. I happened to be away, we were on vacation 2 weeks ago, and I didn't get to hear in person their experience. So I, again, went to YouTube, heard Becky talk about experiences in Haiti and who they encountered, and can almost see the pictures, not really very well on YouTube. And then Aaron got up and spoke. And the words that came out of his mouth were words that I've had in my head for a couple of years about being in mission and in service to your community. Just tied right in with what Pastor Susan was saying. That Aaron said, you don't have to be a missionary like Mother Teresa or someone that goes to another country and devotes their life, or large chunks of their life, to serve other people. You can do it right here in our community. And that's exactly what I've been feeling that we need to, that I don't want to say about we, that I need to work on. So, it was just surprising to me that right here in this community, in our church home, were two people that were saying things that were on my heart. You hear the word evangelism. It's kind of a scary word. You think about going out and standing in public, like not even in church. Church is comfortable because here we're safe. I can talk to you and I may say something that doesn't come out exactly right, or I'm preaching to the choir, because we all know what God expects of us, or we have an idea anyway. But when we go out into the world, to get up like a Billy Graham or other Joel Osteen or Joyce Meyer and speak publicly to thousands or hundreds of thousands of people, that's a big intimidating thing. Just like being a missionary and going far and wide to do that. So what do we do? Aaron gave us some ideas. We had some ideas, an invitation for an idea just this morning from Pastor Susan in volunteering for the Pregnancy Care Center, that they are in need of people to save lives, changing lives. So many of you may be aware that I'm getting ready to go to India again. It'll be my third trip, taking the group over to do medical mission camps and evangelism and working with orphans and elderly. And in preparation for those trips, we try to look for a guiding theme or a guiding verse. 2 years ago, it was from Matthew 5, verses 16 and 17. Let your light so shine before others, so they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. And I think we did a pretty good job. And not only did we hopefully share our light with the folks in India, but it sure sparked lights in the people that went. I know two of the kids that went with us have gone off. One, hopefully, to be a political leader who will be an inspiration to us, another to be a nurse. Another one who hasn't quite graduated from high school yet plans to go be a teacher. She discovered what her goal was being in India. We get so many more rewards from serving others and missioning to others. You've heard that before. It's almost a cliche, but cliches are based in truth, and it definitely is true. So in this coming trip, we were casting about trying to find a message or a guiding theme for what we wanted to do. And when you go to India, we want to be an example, a shining example. And last time we were lights and doing good deeds. As we heard in our scripture readings, from beginning of scripture to the end, what is the theme? The theme is love. God says to love Him with everything we have and love one another. So I found this devotional, and I'm going to read a portion of it to you because I think it speaks directly to what Susan and Aaron said and what I've been feeling and what Brother Praveen does daily. I'm going to read this little piece. I found this on my devotional app on my phone, and it says, through His children, God is trying to show the world what He is like. Jesus said, as the Father has sent me, I also send you. Jesus came to love the world, and He calls us to do likewise in every facet of life. The only way that others will ever find His joy and peace and love and happiness and heaven is through us. No matter where we are from, if we have Jesus, we we are now his ambassadors and represent the King of Kings, the one who runs the universe. Those first Christians turned the world upside down with the love of God. The way they lived convinced others that their faith was real. Even their Roman persecutors marveled. Look at how these Christians love one another. Who is this Christ? They asked the Christians. And how does he make you so happy? Even though you have nothing, you've got everything. How can I find this kind of happiness too? Today, nearly 2,000 years later, the heart of man is still the same. So many people are searching for love, but seldom, if ever, finding it. People everywhere are looking around for some little ray of hope, some salvation, some bright spot somewhere, a little love, a little mercy, some place where they can find some relief. We who have found God and his love have what others have been searching for all their lives and need desperately. And if we can show them that love exists, then they can believe that God exists, because God is love. So, what can we do? We can volunteer for the Pregnancy Care Center. If I had my pictures, we can help with the Cajun Bible School, and there's no age limit to this. You can be a six-year-old helping to package food. You can be 90 and sitting and smiling and helping with Vacation Bible School and encouraging children. I have a picture of Miss Marie down there a couple years ago, and it just warms, every time I see that photo, it warms me. You can use little things to be a missionary, to be an evangelist. A smile, the kindness on your face, the influence your life can shed light on many and have an amazing effect on the people that you come in contact with. So our guiding verse for our coming trip, and I hope for the lives of the people that are traveling with me in December, and for myself going from the time I discovered this verse and finding more ways to do it, by this all shall know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. That's from John 13, verse 35. That's our guiding scripture. So just as it was said in Deuteronomy, love is the key. It's the bottom line. If you have love, then you have everything. And if you can show love to your neighbors, as Jesus commands us to do, in whatever small way, stepping out of your comfort zone. This is not my comfort zone, being here, but sometimes you just feel compelled to do something. Lend a hand. Offer a smile. Love those who are seemingly unlovable. Sometimes it's really difficult to show kindness and love to people who sometimes are kind of unlovable. I unfortunately see folks like that daily at my office where I work. You know, it's not always easy, but people are hurting, and if we can offer anything, a smile, a helping hand, a few dollars, whatever small thing we can do, or if we can do a bigger thing. Sometimes those little things lead to bigger things, and that's what I'm praying for myself, is that the little things that I can do can become bigger things, and I hope that that can be the case for each of us, to step outside that comfort zone, to love God and love our neighbor. So you kind of took my little speech there with, they'll know we are Christians, because that is definitely walking hand in hand and working side by side. We can have revival and be a missionary in everything we do, just by smiling and loving and taking action. Thank you.
closing song. Happens to be one of my favorites. I learned this song at summer camp at Coconut Plateau. So hopefully all of you will rise and sing with passion. Pass it on.
Thank you. Oh, did you?
Not there anymore.